On the 9th of August 2024, an ATS-72 from Voepass Linhas Aéreas entered a flat spin and crashed, resulting in the loss of 58 passengers and 4 crew members. Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magnar Nordahl, I'm an ATI captain and instructor. Today it is Friday 23rd of August 2024. And I will be sharing the facts we have so far about the accident. I will also be answering some questions from the viewers. However, I won't be responding to comments like this. In aviation, we rely on facts, not feelings. And I won't engage in any speculations either. First, I need to correct 2 details from the initial video. The destination was Guarulhos Airport, not Viracopos. And the number of passengers were 58, not 57. In the recent days, many rumors have been circulating. Here are just a few of them. Many people assume the flight encountered severe icing. Yes, there was a warning for severe icing in the area where the aircraft crashed, but we do not yet know whether icing played a role here. It has also been claimed that the aircraft encountered temperatures of minus 40 degrees. If that is true, icing would not have been a concern. At such low temperature, water droplets in the atmosphere instantly freeze into ice crystals, just like you see with the contrails of the jet aircraft. News outlets have reported that the cockpit voice recorder indicates one of the pilots mentioned adding more power. However, this information is not very helpful, since we don't know when the pilot said it. And this information is not confirmed yet. Some people suggest that the pilots requested to descend, but they were denied by air traffic control. However, this is not confirmed yet. Some claim that one propeller was feathered and that caused the spin. From the video recordings, it is very hard to determine this due to the Doppler effect, which makes it challenging to assess the status of the engines and propellers. In my experience observing aerobatic aircraft at air shows, the sound of the engine and propeller changes as the aircraft rotates during spins. Rather than speculating, let's focus on the facts provided by official sources. The aircraft was an ATS-72-500 with serial number 908. It was built in 2010. The first operator was Bel Air in Albania. The company ceased operations in 2013. In 2014, Nordic Aviation Capital, a leasing company based in Denmark, acquired the aircraft. It was then leased to Pelita Air Service in Indonesia in 2015, and in 2012, it was leased to Voepass. A SIGMET, Significant Meteorological Information, was issued for severe icing, affecting the last part of the flight. The Aeronautical Accidents Investigation and Prevention Center of Brazil, CENIPA, has confirmed that the aircraft was in a flat spin when it crashed. CENIPA has confirmed that both the cockpit voice recorder and flight data recorder have been recovered and their data downloaded. Additionally, air traffic control radar data and communication logs have been secured. The flight data recorder installed in the aircraft did not meet the current requirements set by the National Civil Aviation Agency of Brazil, ANAC. In 2023, ANAC issued an 18-month temporary license allowing the aircraft to operate without certain parameters recorded by the flight data recorder. These missing parameters include navigation frequencies, brake pressure, brake pedal application, hydraulic pressure, trim command positions, and flight control command forces. However, the flight data recorder recorded hundreds of other parameters, and they will all be examined. The investigators will need to thoroughly examine and rule out as many possibilities as possible. Some key questions include: were any parts of the aircraft missing before impact? What were the weight and center of gravity of the aircraft? Did the following systems function properly? The engines and propellers, flight controls, stall protection system, flight instruments, weather radar, and if the aircraft was in icing conditions, did the ice protection system and aircraft performance monitoring, APM, work? It will take time to synchronize and analyze all the data. A preliminary report with the factual information will be released 30 days after the accident. After that, the investigation will begin to uncover the reasons behind the incident, and this could take 1 or 2 years. I will now answer some questions raised after the accident. How could icing be a problem in a tropical area like Brazil? The air temperature drops by 2 degrees Celsius for every 1,000 feet of altitude. So if it's plus 30 degrees Celsius at sea level, it would be 0 degrees at 15,000 feet. And this is an altitude turboprops usually use. Currently, it is winter in Brazil, and the temperatures on the ground can drop well below 10 degrees. Does the ATR have a device that informs the pilots of ice formation? Yes. There is an electronic ice detector that alerts the pilots when ice forms on a sensor. The sensor is under one of the wings. Additionally, there is an ice evidence probe located outside the captain's side window. When ice accumulates on this probe, it is an indication that ice is forming on the airframe as well. Does the ATR have anti-icing equipment? Yes, it is equipped and certified for flight in icing conditions. The following areas are heated: pitot tube, static ports, angle of attack vane, temperature probe, windshield, side windows, propellers, and flight control horns. The following areas are protected by de-icing boots: the wing leading edge, the horizontal stabilizer, and engine air intakes. How does the de-icing boots work? They consist of rubber tubes that inflate and deflate alternately using compressed air from the engine. This causes the ice to break away. While most aircraft have de-icing boots oriented horizontally, ATR aircraft have boots aligned chordwise, and that makes them more efficient. The boots are activated when ice forms on the airframe. What sensor does the APM use? APM is the aircraft performance monitoring system. It receives the following information: pressure altitude, static air temperature, total air temperature, indicated airspeed, engine torque, propeller rotation speed, NP, landing gear position, flaps position, aircraft weight, fuel flow, longitudinal acceleration, and flight director altitude hold mode. All of those are monitored. The APM then calculates theoretical drag and compares it to actual drag. If the actual drag exceeds specified limits, the APM issues alerts at 3 levels. The first alert, cruise speed low, doesn't have an oral warning since it activates very early at cruise speed just 10 knots below normal cruise speed. The next alert, degraded performance, and also increased speed, will trigger a single chime and flashing master caution lights. Can the propeller brake be activated in flight? No, that is not possible. The propeller brake is used to prevent the propeller from spinning when the engine is running on the ground. This enables the aircraft to be self-sufficient with electric power and air condition. To operate the propeller brake, the following conditions must be met. 1. Aircraft on the ground, as sensed by the weight on wheel switches. 2. Gust lock engaged. This means both power levers are in ground idle position. 3. Condition lever number 2 in feather or fuel shut off. And 4. Blue hydraulic pressure. In other words, it is impossible for the propeller brake to be engaged in flight. What causes an airplane to spin? Every spin starts with a stall, which means the airflow over the wing is disrupted. This causes a certain loss of lift. A wing will stall when the angle of attack exceeds a critical value. The angle of attack is the angle between the wing cord and the onflowing air. For ATR, the critical value is 17 degrees when the wing is clean. When there is ice on the wing can stall at less angle of attack. The aircraft is equipped with a stick shaker. In normal flight, it is activated at 10.9 degrees angle of attack. And at 8 degrees when the anti-icing equipment has been selected on. If the angle of attack continues to increase, the stick pressure is activated. It forces the control column forward and by doing this reduces the angle of attack. It is very powerful. And this should be sufficient to prevent a stall. However, if the aircraft encounters severe icing, the ice accretion might be so severe that the wing will stall before the stick shaker is activated. And this is when the APM comes into play. Ice accumulation increases aerodynamic drag, and the APM will issue warnings to the pilots. But if you stall, the stall recovery is as following. You push the control column forward, that reduces the angle of attack. If the flaps is retracted, you set flap 15. That reduces the stall speed, and then you apply power as necessary. You let the aircraft accelerate to a safe speed, and then you pull gently out of the dive. If you pull too hard, the aircraft may stall again. And all pilots are trained to do this. But if you stall the aircraft, and at the same time there's a yawing moment, that means the aircraft is rotating around the vertical axis, the aircraft may enter a spin. Such a yawing moment can be caused by asymmetric power or by applying the rudder. I can't understand how the pilots were unable to stop the aircraft from spinning horizontally. Some light aircraft, especially those certified for aerobatic maneuvers, can recover from a spin due to their large control surfaces and a carefully managed center of gravity. The standard spin recovery procedure is called PARE, power to idle, ailerons neutral, rudder opposite of the spin, and elevator forward. However, large aircraft, and especially those with wing-mounted engines, are generally unable to recover from a spin. The weight of the engines generates a significant gyroscopic force, and the flight controls lack the authority to counteract the spin. A spin can then develop into a flat spin if the correct spin recovery procedure is not applied, for example by not reducing power or by applying the ailerons against the spin. It is nearly impossible to recover from a flat spin, even for some aerobatic aircraft. The reason is that in a flat spin, the tail fin rotates sideways well outside the center of gravity, and this causes the vertical stabilizer to stall. And the rudder has no effect at all. Therefore, aircraft are equipped with systems that warns the pilots before the aircraft is stalled, and the pilots are trained to avoid the stall, and if they enter a stall, they are trained to recover from the stall by pushing the aircraft's nose down. As I have said before, and we continue to stress, we need to be patient and let the investigators do their job. Accidents rarely stem from just one cause. Usually, they result from a series of events, some of which may differ from our initial assumptions. The preliminary report will be available in a couple of weeks. In the meantime, be patient. Thank you for watching.